Well, hello everyone, and welcome to what will be a series of videos which we'll release each Sunday during this season in which we are unable to meet together as church in person. In fact, welcome to St. John's Community Church, because whether we're in our building or not, church life continues, because we, as God's people, are the church wherever we find ourselves. And the good news is, wherever we find ourselves, God's Spirit is with us. It's good to be with you today. And so perhaps let's pray that God may use our time together to encourage us through what we see and hear, to know his peace, his provision, and his protection in the midst of such uncertainty. Also, perhaps let's pray that God would inspire us to do good stuff for those in need, and to place our lives afresh into the hands of a God who loves us and cares for us more than we could ever imagine. Now, my name's Matt. I'm the vicar at St. John's, and I'm feeling my way with this online recorded session type stuff. All a bit weird, doing it on my Todd, I know. And in fact, I know some vicars are doing live streams for their churches this morning, but trust me, you don't want to be looking at my ugly mug in close up on your screen for that long. Times are bleak enough as it is. So each week I'll put in some videos, some slides. We'll have some music and worship songs, some reflections, maybe some interviews as we go along. And so as a way of helping us to take time on this day to focus on God, his love for us and the world, and how we might be equipped by him to share that same love with those we live alongside. Indeed, I want to kick off today's little offering with a story from the Bible. This one's from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, verses 1 to 4. Here's a little video of it in which Jesus says this.
Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets to be honored by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you.
Now, we'll come back to those words of Jesus in a bit, but let's first address the elephant in the room, this coronavirus pandemic, which has prompted unprecedented disruption and anxiety, illness, and sadly the loss of many lives across the world, with the reality that many more will suffer before the curve flattens and life begins, hopefully, to recover some sense of normality. Such a surreal time for us to be living through. Scenes on our screens and on our streets reminiscent of a Hollywood disaster movie as sort of life shuts down and panic in some places sets in. I don't know about you, but during these last few weeks, I've been kind of wavering between two extremes. You know, on the one hand, real concern, fear even, as to what's here, what's to come, and how we might cope with it. Indeed, in many ways, we'd be daft not to be concerned for our families, our friends, our world, as this virus spreads and causes so much social and financial and spiritual and physical dis-ease. And yet, on the other hand, there are some mornings of late when I've woken up, you know, particularly on those rare days when the sun has been shining and all seems relatively calm outside. You know, those mornings when I wake up, I get sometimes a sense of optimism that despite our current difficulties, and there are real difficulties which I know so many folks are already facing, but despite that reality, I get the sense that things will be all right and we can get through this. Now, What's the cause of this optimism? How might we keep our fears and our worries in check, or at least in proportion, so that we don't become overwhelmed by anxiety? Well, I'd say that's where that clip of the Bible passage from Matthew's Gospel comes in. Timeless words which Jesus shared with the crowds of people who were following him some 2,000 years ago. If you recall, he said this. He said, "When you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets as the hypocrites do to be honoured by others. But when you give to the needy, do not let your right hand know what your left hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret." Now, there's a lot in these few words, but a few little things worth picking out perhaps for us today. I think firstly, notice that Jesus says, when you give to the needy, not if you give. There's an expectation from Jesus that we will give to those in need. You know, he doesn't stipulate how much that should be. Indeed, on another occasion, he championed a poor widow who gave just tuppence, into the temple collection. 2 pennies which, to most eyes, didn't amount to much, but which, to Jesus' eyes, made for an incredibly generous donation, because that was all that this particular woman had to give. You know, what Jesus calls each of us to have is an attitude of compassion and generosity to those who are in need. Fine principles, maybe. And yet, I guess when we've popped into Morrison's or Aldi of late and seen people stockpiling pretty obscene amounts of toilet paper or pasta or whatever, we might be tempted to despair at the greed and the selfishness on display. And that despair can in turn feed our own anxieties that we ourselves might miss out, you know, and perhaps we need to be more aggressive in getting our trolleys down the aisle and our cupboards stocked and so on. So yeah, when we see how some people behave, we may well feel anxious, fearful, angry even. And yet, in between those episodes of greed which a minority of people get sucked into, I know for me, I've also seen in our town over these last few weeks a huge number of people going above and beyond in order to help those in need. And so whether that's the leaflets through people's doors offering neighbourly assistance, the donated food being given away to those who are hungry, the pubs who are committing to cook free hot meals for those who are isolated, the teachers who have worked tirelessly to ensure our children's education can continue from home, the doctors and nurses, the pharmacists and the carers who risk their own health in order to look after those at risk. You know, these are the things which give me hope for the future, hope in our town, hope in the goodness which God is able to prompt in all of us if we're open to that inner voice nudging us to be kind, to be generous, to be self-giving. And what's more, just as Jesus says that giving is done best in a quiet, unassuming, even he says secret way, so that we do it for the right motives. You know, I've also had the privilege of seeing that in action this week with various folks approaching me or Marie in the church office to quietly, humbly offer their time or drop off some tins for the food bank or whatever. You know, it's that lack of ego, that lack of wanting praise, which also gives me optimism. You know, that despite the trolley hoarders, there are so many signs of hope in the love which I would say God inspires in our community. In fact, I want to play a little clip of an interview with the late Fred Rogers, Mr. Rogers, whose life as a children's TV presenter was recently made into a film starring Tom Hanks. It's a top film, by the way. Do check it out if you haven't seen it already. But have a listen here to what the real life Mr. Rogers had to say.
You know, my mother used to say a long time ago, whenever there would be any really catastrophe that was in the movies or on the air, she would say, always look for the helpers. There will always be helpers, you know, even just on the sidelines. That's why I think that if news programs could make a conscious effort of showing rescue teams, of showing who medical people, anybody who is coming into a place where there's a tragedy, to be sure that they include that. Because if you look for the helpers, you'll know that there's hope.
You know, it's interesting that Jesus finishes that little teaching he gives about giving to the needy by saying that when we give in a humble, quiet way, then, he says, then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. What does that reward from the Father, from God, look like? Well, I don't think it's necessarily a reward in a financial sense. In fact, I think we're on dodgy ground if we only give because we ourselves hope to get something back and receive. You know, that's not the way of God's economy, in that we want prosperity for ourselves. Nah. Rather, I'd say these rewards are twofold. Firstly, we get the peace which comes from knowing we've made someone else's life a little bit better. Peace because it takes our focus away from ourselves and our own troubles, and instead realigns our eyes to empathise with those who are likely to be worse off than we are. So one of the main ways God rewards our giving and generosity is by giving us his peace. Something I imagine we'd all want more of at the moment. But secondly, the reward we receive is the knowledge that we've in some way rekindled hope in others. You know, to paraphrase Mr. Rogers, where there's help, there's hope. And just as we need peace in our own lives, so too our community, our country, our world needs to have a sense of hope, now perhaps more than ever. What is hope? Well, it's not the fingers crossed, you know, touch wood, be lucky kind of hope. No, rather, it's a hope grounded in truth. The truth that compassion, that kindness, that generosity will prevail. The truth that love never fails. If you look for the helpers, you'll know that there's hope. Who is the ultimate helper? Well, the book of Hebrews in the Bible tells us this. It says, the Lord is my helper. And because of that, we can say, I will not be afraid. I will not be afraid. I know it's hard at the moment for us not to be afraid. I know that. But what these words of Jesus tell us is that when we give to the needy, when we put the needs of others before our own, then not only will we know a sense of inner peace and well-being, and not only will others be given hope because of our help, but it draws us closer to God and his ways. And a closeness to God, you know, a connection with the one who is the greatest help we could know. Well, that, I would say, helps us to not be afraid, whatever life may throw at us. So my hope for us this week is that we'd be generous. Generous with our money, our resources, our time, our love. And there are obvious ways to put those things into practice at the moment. but I'll leave you to work out with God what that might look like in your life this week. But in our generosity and through our giving, in whatever way that comes, my prayer is that we and our community might know God's peace and God's hope, so that we won't be afraid of whatever lies ahead. Indeed, let me lead us in a prayer. A prayer which Richard, the vicar from St. Anne's in Chasetown, has written especially for today. Loving God, we lift to you ourselves and our loved ones in these difficult and worrying times. We think of people who are needing to stay at home, who may feel alone and scared. Please give them your peace. Give them friends to contact them and care for them. We remember people who are worried about money and food and whether they will have enough. We think of people who have lost their jobs and people anxious about rent and mortgages. Please calm their fears and provide for them. As schools close, we pray for children and young people that they will be safe and that they will be able to learn and develop despite such a different pattern of life. We pray for our nurses, doctors, care workers and all the NHS staff who are caring for those who are sick. Lord, thank you for their remarkable work. Give them strength, skill and compassion, and please protect them. We pray for anxious shoppers worried about getting food and essentials. Help us, please, to buy what we need and share what we have. We lift to you our national and local leaders. Please give them good advisors, wisdom to choose the best way forward. Help them to lead us well. Please help research scientists and all who are searching for a vaccine and other methods of treating this illness. Give them insight and fresh ideas and the ability to work together. For our town and our neighbourhood, help us to look out for each other, to come together and offer practical care. Please help churches and other faith and community groups to live out their calling and honour you. And Lord, we pray for your world, for the millions of people affected by the coronavirus outbreak. Help those in countries which have been so badly affected and all those in places where healthcare is not good or not fair. And we pray for ourselves that you will give us hope and inspire us. Help us to trust that you will bring us through these difficult times. And may we come through to be people who live lives which are changed for the better. Thank you for your great love for us and that you never leave us when we need you most. We pray, remembering Jesus' radical pattern of life and service. May we follow him. Amen. Amen. It'd be good to listen to a recording of the band at St. John's leading us in a worship song called God, I Look to You. It's a song which speaks of the help which comes from God and our response to that. So maybe turn up the volume a bit for this one. Sing along if you want to. But let's use this song as our song of worship and prayer to God. Okay. We'll leave it there for today. Thanks for being part of this little online offering. First of what may be a few more weeks to come. But in the meantime, may God continue to provide, protect, and perhaps above all, inspire us to bring his peace, his hope, and his help to those around us. May God bless you, that you may in turn be a blessing to others. And we'll see you next time.